I'm going to ask you a question and don't Google it. What's the biggest agricultural power in Europe? Who is the biggest food exporter in the entire European Union? Now, many of you might think Spain, Italy, or maybe even France. After all, these countries have good weather and thousands upon thousands of hectares of arable land. None of these countries, though, comes close to the Netherlands, also known as Holland. To give you a better idea, the Netherlands is almost the largest food exporter in the world, second only to the United States. And this is kind of a surprise because we're talking about a country here that is so small they had to build dams to reclaim land from the sea. In fact, it's one of the most densely populated countries in the world. To this, we need to add the fact that they are one of the richest and most modern countries on the planet. The first stock market was created in Amsterdam, and I'm sure all of you know Dutch companies like Shell, Philips, or the bank ING. Normally, when a country has many industrial or service companies, agriculture is placed on the back burner. So now you might be wondering, well, why? Why is the Netherlands such a big food producer?
Well, imagine that we have a piece of land, for example, say in Spain, that measures 1 hectare. If we use it to plant potatoes, we can earn between 7,000 and 8,000 euros per hectare. Now imagine instead the amount of money that we could earn if we use that area to build a factory or an office building.
When you do that kind of math, it quickly becomes clear why countries move away from agriculture. Well, despite all of this, Holland is the world leader of potato exports, above France, above Spain, above even the USA. And now I can probably guess what some of you are thinking. Agriculture in Europe? I mean, Brussels has got to be giving out grants somewhere, right? Agriculture is indeed one of the most protected sectors with the most aid in the entire European Union. However, the Netherlands isn't the country that receives the most money. Of course, they receive aid like any other member country, but they don't even get a third of what Greece gets. And if we compare it with larger countries like France, the difference in aid is huge. So how is it possible that with so little land and so little help, Holland has become the garden of the world? Well, as you can imagine, the answer is simply explained in one word. Technology. In a farm in the Netherlands, we can find tractors that drive themselves, drones that monitor crops, and of course, resource optimization at the highest level. However, there's still a question here. Why does Holland have more modern agriculture than, for example, Spain? Also, what has the Netherlands done that can be imitated in other countries? Well, today we're going to answer these questions, but before we do, let's take a look back at the history.
From the field to the university.
In the 1970s, Holland had one of the most prosperous economies in all of Europe. Companies such as Philips and Airbus were conquering the international market. And all of this was great news for the Netherlands. But as we always say on VisualPolitik, not everything was a field of roses. Imagine being 20 years old and living in the Netherlands back then. Where would you have liked to work? In an international company like Philips with high salaries and good conditions? Or on your father's farm? Well, exactly. Dutch agriculture, it was on the verge of disappearing. And we also have to add something very important to this. As we said before, the Netherlands is very small, and there's hardly any space for large farms. Now, for example, there's plenty of land in the United States, and that means that farmers can group and create large farms. In fact, today, a lot of American farms belong to large corporations. This means that they can scale investments and buy, for example, planes to fumigate huge areas of land. However, in the case of the Netherlands, farms are small, with an average size of around 7 hectares, making large investments really very complicated. To make matters worse, by the 70s, Dutch salaries were already much higher than in other European countries. In other words, unlike the farmers in southern Italy, the Dutch couldn't compete with low prices. And you might be wondering now, why did they need agriculture? After all, in those years, there was already a certain degree of international trade. the Netherlands could import food while they manufactured televisions or airplanes, right? Well, yeah, that is right. And from a purely economic point of view, they could have easily let go of their primary sector. Well, the reality is in life, not everything is just the economy. And in Holland, farming associations have a lot of power, more so than in pretty much every other country.
For example, in many other countries, they have something called the Social Dialogue Table, which is an organization where the government, employers, and unions meet. Well, in the Netherlands, they have something similar. But along with employers and unions, farmers and rancher associations are also well represented. And in the 1970s, Dutch farmers and ranchers weren't willing to change jobs.
So consider yourself put in this situation. Holland had to maintain its primary sector at all costs, but at the same time, all of the odds were stacked against them. At this point, I know what you must be thinking. They did grants. The solution would be to simply give subsidies to farmers so they'd stop protesting. Right? I mean, this wouldn't exactly be the first or the last time that such policies have been applied. But the Dutch government, they actually had other plans. Now that they had to maintain their primary sector, they wanted to do it well. And since they couldn't reduce salaries or group farms, there was only one solution left, and that was to improve productivity. That is, getting the farmers to produce more and better food. Well, how did they do it? Well, that's exactly what we're going to look into right now.
The University of Wageningen.
You've probably heard this sentiment a thousand times. Silicon Valley wouldn't be what it is today if it weren't for Stanford University. It's the mecca on research for everything that has to do with electronics and telecommunications. But they don't only do research, they also train the best computer scientists in the world, and when those computer scientists leave the university, they go directly to big companies like Google, Apple, and Tesla. Well, as far as agriculture is concerned, the mecca of innovation isn't actually in the US, but it's in the Netherlands. We're talking about the University of Wageningen, also known as Food Valley.
Many of you might not have heard about this university. That's because they only work in the world of agriculture. They don't have degrees in law or art history. Wageningen's motto is to improve food quality for the entire world.
So you might be wondering right now, well, what's so special about this university? Well, the first difference is money. The Netherlands knew that they needed technology to improve their farming. So, well, what did they do? Well, they showered their scientists with money. In just two decades, the university's research budget doubled. But hold on just a moment, because money is not the only important thing here. The truth is, the most important thing wasn't how much, but where the money was coming from. You see, in many European countries, and in most of Latin America, there's a very clear line that separates public and private universities. Public universities are funded from the state. Of course, they can have some sort of collaboration with private companies, but that's not their main source of funding. Wageningen's case is different. 50% of their money comes from the government, 25% from the university's own income, and the last 25% from private companies. And I can probably guess what you're thinking right now. Private companies funding a university? Does this mean that the university is private now? Well, no, but it does bring a great advantage. It allows the university to be connected with the rest of society. When we were preparing this video, we had a phone call with a farmer called Cesar Bravo in Spain. More specifically, he's from the Canary Islands, and we asked him about how agricultural modernization works. Now, you might not know this, but livestock is actually very important in the Canary Islands, especially goats. They have a specific type of goat there called the Palmer goat, which is unique from any other breed in the world. There are actually several institutes and foundations dedicated to studying this specific type of goat. However, as Cesar explained, practically none of the studies are actually useful to farmers. I mean, think about it. If you have a goat farm, what kind of research do you really need? As a farmer, you want to know how to produce more and better milk. Studies on how to better feed the animals, dietary supplements, or even genetic engineering are useful. Well, if you go to the ICIA website, for example, which is the Canary Institute of Agricultural Research, you won't find anything like that. There are tons of academic articles that explain the breed origin of the Palmer goat, whether it's related to other goats in Morocco or Tanzania, or if they existed during the Middle Ages. But practical usage? Kind of zero. Meanwhile, according to the Times Higher Education ranking, Wageningen studies are the most cited in their field. But that's not all. I bet you can't guess what the university's official language is. Given that it's in Holland, you'd probably be thinking they would be speaking Dutch, right? Well, no, not at all. We're talking about the capital of agricultural research here. And because of this, more than 40% of the students and research staff are foreign. No matter where you're from, if you have a talent in agriculture, you can get a place at this university.
Record numbers of foreign students at Dutch universities of technology.
Because of this international makeup, the official language of the university is English. That explains why Wageningen is, for example, a pioneer in LED lamps for greenhouses, which allows for the creation of precisely controlled artificial microclimates. Thanks to this, the Netherlands is one of the leaders in tomato growth, even though in natural conditions, tomatoes would never grow in such a cold country. And there's more here. In a country like the US, farmers need about 126 liters of water to grow 1 kilogram of tomatoes. Well, thanks to this university's research, now one can produce the same amount with just 8 liters of water. This is an incredible amount of saving in both economic and ecological terms. But hold on a minute here, because research is good, but it isn't really worth anything if it stays within the university. And in that regard, the Netherlands is again a great example of how things are being done right.
From the university to the field.
Let's get back to Spain for a moment. Imagine that we have a tomato garden and we want to invest in this hydroponic technology that will allow us to save water. The European Union, or more precisely, the Common Agricultural Policy, provides all kinds of grants so that farmers can modernize their fields. So we'll go to the Agricultural Extension Agency, where all of these grants are managed. So the farmers get their money there, and then they will make sure that they spend it on improving production techniques. So far, so good. But how do farmers know which machines to purchase? One would think that the farmer would know better than anyone what their lands would need, but the truth is that the agricultural world evolves as quickly as internet companies. And if nobody advises the farmer, they'll have to find the information out themselves. Well, that's the situation in which almost every Spanish farmer has found themselves. There's a huge gap between the university and the field. The Dutch case, though, is entirely different. In the Netherlands, they have the so-called agricultural council offices. That means that there's someone there who will explain to the farmer what type of machine they need to buy and what technologies are best suited for their type of crop. And what's the result of all of this? Well, Dutch fields look nothing like those in any other country. While most European countries consume tons of antibiotics for their animals, the Netherlands farmers are already using the most advanced veterinarian techniques in such a way that they can prevent diseases instead of curing them. The same happens with plant pesticides. In this country, they noticed that if they use drones to monitor the crops, they can control each and every one of the vegetables and prevent them from becoming infected. And in a country where almost half of the crops are irrigated, they have managed to decrease their water consumption by almost 90%. Further, agricultural product exports surpassed 92 billion euros last year. And not only that, Holland is also making money by exporting their technology.
The United Arab Emirates goes Dutch to ensure their food security.
So the question now becomes, do you think other countries can import these kinds of policies? How far can the technologies developed in Holland go to feed the rest of the world? Well, leave your answer in the comments below. And before we finish, I'd like to thank Cesar Bravo and Angel Gargo from AGQ Nutrition for helping us with this video. And if you're interested in this subject, we'll soon be releasing another video explaining the common agricultural policy that we mentioned in this video in depth. Also, don't forget to visit our friends at the Reconsider Media podcast. They provided the vocals in this video that were not mine. And as always, do remember that we publish brand new videos every week, so hit that subscribe button and you won't miss a post. And if you like this video, give it a thumbs up. And as always, I'll see you next time.
And if you want to learn more about politics and hear even more of my lovely voice, you can join us at Reconsider Media. We have a podcast at reconsidermedia.com/podcast. See you there.